Hey, it's Monday. I've got mail. You know what that means. Let's look at this first one here. It says resistances. Oh, man. What's going on here? Okay. That actually looks like a module of some sort. What did I buy? It is an LED and key module. So we have 8 push buttons down here and 8 segments of 7-segment LED up there with peely things on them. Cool. Oh, and then there's also 8 individual LEDs across the top. So this is based on the TM1638 chip. Power ground, strobe clock, and data in out. So that's not I squared C. Wonder what format this thing speaks. Anyway, this is clearly a demo board that demonstrates the maximum capability of that chip. So let's go and see what the listing says for this and see what we can do with it, I guess. 8-bit LED, 8-bit, 8-bit key, TM1638 module board plus Dupont line, or some people might call them Dupont line, digital tube IC new, $2.81 Canadian with free shipping, which for something that seems to have a fair bit of functionality is not a bad price these days. Not too much to say about it down here, just the name of the chip and... it only takes 3 I/O ports to talk to it. Oh, it scans the display and keys without other intervention. Okay. So what more can we find out about it? It is a dedicated LED drive control with keypad scan interface. All right. Interfaces with a microcontroller, data latch, LED drive, keyboard scanning circuit. Oh, yeah, that would be a reasonable thing to use it for, is just microwaves and air conditioners and stoves and appliances, basically, that don't need a huge amount of interface. Yeah. So it looks like it handles the LED segments and keyboard inputs as part of the same, as the same pin, and then just addresses each group of 8 at a time. So 10 segments. Or you know, 8 key switches and or 10 LED segments times 8 grid locations, up to 80 outputs or combination of 80 outputs and inputs, possibly. That would be pretty versatile. Presumably there is an Arduino library to support this thing. And yeah, of course there is an Arduino library. Woohoo! I'll have to play with this thing at some point in the future and just see... how to make it work, just for the fun of it, you know? Follow my curiosity. Well, that's off to a good start. Let's see what this next one is. It says power plug sockets. They feel chunky through the bag. Let's see what we got. Oh, yeah. So the first one is an IEC male power input with a switch and a fuse compartment. Even contains a fuse. Excellent. A 10 amp fuse. Okay. Well, that's nice to have. That'll be very useful in a project. And then the other one is another fused input. Also includes fuse. And it came with a do-it-yourself female connector to mate with it. Yeah, I know we don't call them male and female anymore. I'm old. I'm set in my ways. Sorry. Anyway, yeah, so if you just want to make up your own power cable rather than using the ubiquitous computer power cord that every one of us has 30 of lying around, that is quite nice. As I said, will definitely come in handy in future projects. IEC 320 C14, which is the full spec of that. Electrical AC socket, 3-pin red LED, 250-volt rocker switch, 10-amp fuse. This seller has a whole bunch of variants on the theme. But this is the first one that I opened up. It costs $4 Canadian. And there is the second one, cost also $4 Canadian, which is just the fuse and the socket, but not switched. And also the plug, I guess, also $4. But again, in this whole range of things, they have all kinds of different stuff. Oh, there's that figure eight input one. Very handy to find all these things in one spot. What is that one? I don't recognize that plug. I probably should pick up a few more random assortments out of these, at least the ones that I recognize, and in different physical shapes. This one has the mounting lugs on top. The one I got has the lugs on the end, just for different situations. Next in, we have, it says lead test swabs. Okay, that I'm pretty sure I know what it is, if it's not lying to me. Yeah, that's exactly what it is, lead test swabs. So I got these to, well, exactly as the package says, test for lead. My wife has recently been picking up some antique china dishware, that kind of stuff. And she's a little bit concerned as to whether or not there's lead on them. Okay, they've got a sealed for your protection. I'm not going to open them. So they have these little chemical treated swabs in there. And you wet the top, the tip of the swab, rub it on your thing, and check the color of it to see whether or not there is lead. If it turns red or violet or pink, then there is lead. And if it doesn't change color from whatever that is, then there's not lead. So hopefully this will help put her mind at ease about some of this antique stuff that she's been buying. Laboratory lead test kit with 30 testing swabs. Rapid test results in 30 seconds. $10.45. That's fairly expensive, I guess, but maybe not for what it does. Yeah, testing for lead paint is sort of the main job that these things tend to be used for. And around my shop, I'm not too concerned about lead because I know the solder I'm using has lead because it says right on it. But for dishes and glassware and stuff like that, I suppose it's useful to know whether or not the stuff's got lead in the paint. High sensitivity, just dip in vinegar and then rub the testing surface. Disposable in regular waste, that's useful to know. Instant test results, cool. Apparently the active ingredient in it, sodium rhodizionate, I guess you pronounce it that way. Apparently that is a legitimate test. So as long as these are not completely counterfeit, they should do the job and put my wife's mind at ease. All right, moving right along, we have something that has the label covered up. Fine, be like that. An assortment pack of, looks like, crimp connectors. So we've got crimp pins of both persuasions, and we've got 2-pin, 3-pin, 4-pin, and 5-pin. Again, going both directions. So if I ordered the correct thing, these should be the ones that are compatible with the connectors that come on the LED strips on these WS2811. Yes, they are. That is the right one. Cool. That's why I ordered them. Oh, boy. Those are, when they're on, they're on. Okay. So the 3-pin is why I really got them. But the rest of those, I'm sure, will come in handy for other applications because this isn't the only application that they're used. Actually, the straight up RGB strips also use the 4-pin one. So the 2-pin one is probably going to be useful just for normal powering things. As always, they'll come in handy eventually. I'd rather have them and not need them than need them and not have them. 200-piece set, connectors, terminal wire, 2, 3, 4, 5-pin, 2.54mm DuPont plug, male-female. Yeah, they're not what we normally call DuPont wires, but then again, what we call DuPont wires are not really an exclusive product of the DuPont company, are they? I'm sure they make similar things. Anyway, that's a sidetrack. These cost me $14.04 Canadian for this whole set. Doesn't say too much about them down here other than describing them. And here it describes them as JST housings. Right. So this is a four-channel digital radio system, remote control. Operates on 2 gigahertz. What else do we know about it? So you can use it for model cars or model boats, and probably anything. RF power, less than 20 dBm. 6 volts DC, 1.5 volt batteries, black, bada, bada, bada. Not a huge amount of information there, which means let's pop it out and see what it really is. Now, this is, of course, going to be the cheapest one that I could find on eBay or AliExpress or somewhere, but it will, I hope, be useful just to play with and learn a little bit about how these RC vehicle controllers work. So you have 4 AA cells there. Connect to battery, receiver, electronic speed control, motor, steering servos. Cool. So probably, I know I've got some servos around here. I think I've got ESC with one of those brushless DC motors. So I should be able to at least get it to do some things. There's some settings to bind the receiver and transmitter together. Cool. So, there's the receiver right there. Comes with a little sticky Velcro pad, a little jumper wire, presumably for programming. So the transmitter calls itself a 4-channel transmitter, but this receiver says it is a 6-channel receiver. So hopefully they're somewhat compatible with each other. And then it looks like, does the power go separately or no, it must just come in one of these sets of pins, and the pins are laid out the same as they are on servos, signal and then plus and then minus across there. So I guess that's how you also get power into it. Channel 6 is where you put your VCC in, I suppose. Channel 3 is the bind, which I guess is what the jumper is for. I don't know, I'm going to have to read the manual a little bit more and do some, probably translation, because there's a lot of Chinese in the manual. Anyway, there's the controller itself. It's got a forward-backwards and presumably potentiometer for speed control. That looks like a steering wheel, doesn't it? Sure. Then up on top here, we have a power LED, low battery LED, throttle, normal and reverse directions, steering normal and reverse so that you don't have to deal with it manually. That's kind of cool. Power switch down there. Channel 4, LT and R, I'm not quite sure. Channel 3 is just an on-off button. Throttle trim, so that means that's just to put a physical offset if the center position on that or the trigger down here is not actually centered on what you're controlling. So throttle and steering dual rate. So I guess that's acceleration rate. EPA on throttle, don't know what that means. Channel 5 and channel 6. I thought this thing called itself a 4-channel radio. But it's talking about channel 5 and 6 there. Channel 4 seems to just be a 3 position. Channel 3 is just a pushy button. AUSTAR RC transmitter receiver, 2.4 gig, 3-channel, 4-channel, 6-channel kit for RC 1/10, 1/8 car. It appears that I actually did buy the 6-channel set for $46.69 Canadian for another $4 shipping, which, as I mentioned and as any regular viewers will know, is going to be the cheapest one that I could find, because that's just what I do here. Universal RC controller and receiver kit works in the 2.4 gigahertz unlicensed band divided into 160 wave bands. So theoretically, as long as you're paired before you're in the range of other people, you should be able to operate around other people. Cool. Yeah, it uses frequency hopping just to keep out of the way of other transmitters. So that's nice. 4 AA batteries. Yeah. 3-channel, 4-channel, 6-channel. So the 6-channel version, RF power less than 20 dB, response time 10 seconds to 12 milliseconds. That's quite the range. I'm assuming they mean 10 to 12 milliseconds. Range 150 meters, so not screamingly huge, but not bad for a cheap thing. Low voltage warning at 7.4 or 4.8 volts. The receiver, 6 channels, runs between 4 and 6.5 volts. That's useful information. So I can power it off 5 volts, 5 grams. Yeah, I guess if you're going to throw this in an airplane or something, you want it to be nice and light. So I've still got quite a bit to learn about this RC stuff. And no doubt you'll see some of that experimentation coming up at some point in the future, especially if it winds up in a horrendous failure. That's always amusing to watch. And there we go, the contents of yet another Mailbag Monday haul. So this should be an interesting little IO expander thing just to play with. Handy, I suppose, chip to base control panel stuff on. That's kind of neat. These will be useful in future projects. And the reason that I thought to go looking for alternatives is the salvaged ones that I've got are just the input. And I already used one of those in that power supply I built a month or two back. So restocking and getting a variety of different ones for future projects. These connectors, as I mentioned, I bought specifically to get the 3-pin ones for LED strips, but the 4-pin ones will also work for some. And just always handy to have a variety of connectors around the shop. Lead test strips, keeping the wife happy so that she doesn't concern herself that she's poisoning us with her antique dishes that she's been buying lately. And this cheap remote control controller. That should be fun to play with, just for creating remote control vehicles or remote controlling any kind of robot arm or things like that. And as I said, it was nice and cheap when I bought it, so we'll see if it is actually functional or if I wasted my money and should have spent $20 more and got a better one. We shall see. Anyway, thanks for watching. Thanks to my YouTube channel members and my Patreon supporters for helping me keep the mailbags rolling in. I do appreciate that. And thanks to the viewers, of course. Without you guys, I wouldn't be nearly as motivated to do this stuff. Questions and comments down below, as usual. I'll talk to you later.